listening to the Kobo Writing Life podcast, where we bring you insights and inspiration for growing your self-publishing business. I'm your host, Stephanie McGrath, and the Publisher Operations Specialist here at Kobo Writing Life.
And I'm Tara Kremen, the Author Experience Manager for Kobo Writing Life.
So this week we talked to Michael Anderle about his latest series that's releasing this month, Opus X. And he gets us kind of behind the scenes of the marketing initiatives that he's done for this specific series.
Yeah, it's a really interesting kind of take on what he's doing. A lot of money going toward it. They hired actors. They've got like movie trailers, different worlds.
Basically, some banners that we could see in his office while we were chatting to him.
Yeah, it's really exciting.
We also learned a little bit of how he got into self-publishing, first starting as a voracious reader, I would say.
Yeah, how he learned to write by just being a reader.
Mm-hmm. And reading a lot.
Yeah, all the books.
All the books. And for any longtime listeners of the podcast,
this episode's for you guys.
This is for you. So, Michael, you may have roughly heard about a push-up competition between KWL legends Chrissy and Mark.
Yeah, at 20 Books Vegas, there was a ferocious battle took place
between the two. And Michael is the reason why it happened in the first place. So you're going to learn why a push-up competition happened.
Who won and where did all the money go?
Who knows? You'll have to listen. Only we know. So yeah, we cover a lot in this episode, so please keep listening.
So thank you, Michael, for joining us on the podcast today.
Woohoo!
And just for anyone unfamiliar with you, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
My name is Michael Anderle. I'm a best-selling author, and we've built a company called LMBPN Publishing. That's LMBPN. And for those that are going to go, what in the world is that for? They stand for London, Madrid, Barcelona, Paris, New York, which is only one city off. It's like the publishing centers, but we originally did the letters with Madrid or Milan for the fashion centers. So that's what the letters kind of started out with. And then we used it when we built a publishing company, because the other one was more of a training for my wife, who was an enterprise marketing person. And so she didn't have much experience going enterprise to customer. It was more enterprise into agencies who would then implement projects to get to the end user, or doctors in this case. This will be our fourth year in existence, 11-2, which is the date my first book released, Death Becomes Her. And in that time, we've released quite a few books. We've made friends with quite a few industry companies such as Kobo. And so when we're looking at releasing Opus X, which is going to be what I'd like to say, one story, 12 books, 18 months. And Kobo is one of our go-to partners to help get it out.
Yeah, well, that's great to hear. I can't believe that it's been such a short time, because the number of books that you guys publish is just phenomenal.
Yes. So we have over 600 titles. We have over 200 audio titles, and we've licensed now out about 100 audio titles. And of course, we have 300 titles plus left. Wow. So we, and then of course, we publish anywhere from 15 to 30 plus books a month.
It's a lot. I'm just out of words to try to think about how many books that is.
A lot. It's a somewhere lot. North of hands and feet. So if it's north of hands and feet, then I sit there and go, calculator time.
So how many authors do you work with?
It depends. Like if you think historically, we're probably representing about 45 to 50 authors. But if you mean like any moment in time, because some of those authors would come in, do collaborations, and their goal, quite frankly, is both maybe to learn something of like, why are our books successful? What is the sauce behind, you know, how we write? And the others are frankly could be, hey, I want to get in there. I want some of their fans to read this collaboration so that I can take them back to my own. Which is fine. I understand that. I really don't have an issue with that. But probably 15 to 20 at any one moment in time, even though, of course, over time it aggregates higher.
Maybe tell us a little bit, like, how you got started in all of this. Like, were you always a writer? Is
you know
that
what?
Where you
no.
got your start?
No, I'm not the one who can say I've always been a little kid and I've written all of these. So I've always been an imaginative individual. I took a class in high school, one of those elective classes, that had to do with creating literary magazines and different things. And of course, we would take in stories or art or poems from the student body, and then we would rate them. You know, we'd give them a score, blind test. And so while I was taking this, and I think this is around maybe 10th grade or so, I wrote a story over Thanksgiving holidays. And I go back and I slide my story into the queue. And eventually it comes around to me and I get it and it's marked. Now, mind you, this is one is good. 10 is good, 1 is bad. And I get this and I'm going down 2, 2, 2, one, two, maybe a three. Someone threw me a bone, you know? And so I slid that out of the pile and I stuck it into my notebook, never to write again.
Oh.
And so I did different creative things and I went into computers, computer science, programming, different things for a big chunk of my life, my career. And so, but I always was a reader. I was what I called a whale reader, where I'd read at least a book a week. So 50 plus books a year. And my wife was going to Europe. She had an event every year. So in 2015, 2017, I'm going to have to go back through time. Dang, this is so long ago. I think it was 2015 or whatever. She went and I wrote like 35,000 words while she was gone 1 week. And then I got myself into a corner. I was like, well, what do I do next? I couldn't figure it out. So actually, that was 2014. 2015, a year later, she goes to the same event. It was a conference that happened every year. I pull it back out of the digital drawer and I read it and I find out I'm really engaged with this story. I really like it. So between 2014 and 15, I had reread all of the stories I liked, things that I would come back to over and over again, looking for those aspects of the stories that I enjoyed. And why did I enjoy it? You know, I can think of a John Ringo scene where the point of view was from actually the bad guy. And now this is a bad guy. It was a men's action adventure. So he's about to die. So, but in it, it was, what was he experiencing and why did I enjoy it? And the answer to this particular episode was, I'm very justice oriented. If you're a bad guy, you need to have things done to you because you're a bad guy. And so I was enjoying the fact that he knew his time was coming due. And so there were other scenes where, you know, I might enjoy something because of the friendship, the camaraderie. It had nothing to do with them being active or action oriented. It was the fact that they were sharing a beer and talking and telling jokes. And that was it. Nothing to do with the story, but I was enjoying it. And I took all of these things, these concepts that I liked, and then put it into my book as I move forward. Now I forgot the question. So.
No, that's great. So you kind of learned writing from reading, can you say?
Yes. Yes, yeah. Absolutely, I did. So I've read over 1,000 books in my life and understood why did I like them, why did I not. And indie publishing, quite frankly, was the only place I could get enough content to read. I was taught by TradPub, right? Mm-hmm. I was taught that they put out a book every year, 6 months to a year. So I would often wait 2 or 3 years until 3 books had come out. I don't want to read a story, engage with the characters, love the characters, and then not be able to do the next book. So I'd be constantly on the lookout for when 3 books came along. So you can imagine when digital publishing came along, and now I'm getting access to 4 books at a time, 5 books at a time, some authors putting out 6 books in 6 months. It was nirvana for me, and it was a new experience. So I rapidly moved over to indie authors because they were providing the product I wanted at the time I wanted. And so when it came my turn to put it out, I wrote really hard and really fast to put those books out.
Yeah. And you're a hugely successful indie author. So do you think the speed is a really integral part to this success? I mean, obviously, along with writing excellent stories,
yes.
But do you think it's the turnaround time and kind of like hooking in those readers?
It has become that. Yes. I didn't do it originally because I felt it was everything. What I felt was I needed 3 books before I could market. I looked at it. I have business background. I can look at it and go, okay, at X amount of dollars per book, if it's going to cost me this much per lead, I could do the calculations and go, well, unless I have 3 books, I'm not going to make an ROI on this. So it doesn't pay. So like I need to write 3 books as fast as I can so that I can put marketing to this. And of course, if you're on Kobo, you can use the Kobo marketing aspects and to, you know, dial that down. And so I wrote the 3 books, was able to start marketing them. You know, 4 came out pretty quickly, but then I, quote, slowed down to 28 to 35 days between releases. My first few releases were within a couple of weeks of each other. That includes the writing time. Mm-hmm. So I did that, got it out, got it moved forward, and had enough product for people to start reading, I felt.
Yeah, I think it's really important for indie authors to really consider themselves as businesses and to become very business savvy. So I'm sure having that background was very helpful to you. But is this what led you to sort of, I want to pick your brain on the 20 books to 50K, which is essentially sort of like helping authors create this business. So is that what led to the creation of this kind of platform and what has turned into this bonanza conference?
The concept of 20 books, the name, comes from after I had released 2 books. I was in Cabo San Lucas and I was writing book 3. So you have the beautiful sea, but I'm sitting there type, 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 type.
That sounds like the perfect place.
I know. It is. So, in fact, I think for tax reasons, I think I can say I get my most work done, but no. So, at that point, I learned a couple of things. I learned that I was making about $7 average per book per day at that moment. So, I had two books released. And I'm like, you know what? And I did the calculations on a spreadsheet. I'm like, if I can do, and I had a lot. So I might say, you know, a book's going to make $5. And then I would have columns of five books or $5, $7.50, $10, $12.50. You know, what would they make? And then I did down to 20 books. And I realized that if I were to do 20 books at $7.50 a day, I'd make $50,000 a year, which is a good solid income. Now I had at that point just written two books in the space of a month and a half, and I was about to be finishing my third in a couple of weeks.
Were you still working full time at this point, or was
I had my own company.
Oh,
no,
I
had my own company. So my time was my own to speak of. And that is one, that's a great question that a lot of people miss, realizing I had my own company, I could set my own hours. And not only that, I was in a very unique place in that my main client, who I built ahead of time, got stuck in their own project and didn't have time to tell me to do anything. So I'm getting paid a big chunk of my month with no thing to do.
Beautiful.
You're exactly.
Just like playing to Cabo.
Yes, yes. And also, a lot of people don't know that at the time, my wife was the main breadwinner of the company. I was the one who had his company at home dealing with the children and doing all of that. And she was the one that was outside. So an interesting aspect of Mexico is that their taxes on their homes and everything is very little. So what would cost me $1,000 in Texas a month, even if I paid off the house, I still owe $1,000 a month. In Mexico, that same amount of money would grant me something that maybe I'd pay $600 a year in taxes on. So I started looking at the numbers because I was wanting to retire my wife, quite frankly. Something I perhaps should have considered was whether or not she wanted to be retired.
That's a nice thought all the same.
Yeah. I didn't find out till later that wasn't in her mindset. But anyway, it drove me. And in Mexico, so if you move the money down into Mexico, Cabo San Lucas, and there's a whole lot of other discussions related to it, but let's focus on this part. You have to bring $36,000 of income into the country. They're not going to let you go down there going, what's your job? They don't do that. Well, in books at the time, I'm like, I can make $50,000, so I can surpass this. All of my costs, so that would be if we paid the house off. Let's presume that in the first place, because we were moving money from one house in Texas down to a house in Cabo. This is my theory. I presently live in Las Vegas, so that tells you where things happen. But it was $1,000 a month pays everything, your electricity, your internet, everything except your food. You figure another $1,000 and your food's taken care of, and now you have another $1,000 to go do stuff. And you're in a fun city, fun town to do this thing. So you could retire on $36,000 pretty easily. And so 20 books to 50K, that was me going, that's how I need to make this. Along book five, book six, in my author notes in the back of the books, I was explaining my history, if you will, my ride, my path of being an indie author. And I would encourage people to talk to me on Facebook. Authoring is a very lonely business. And so I was doing that. And four of them started, well, more than four, but four core started asking really relevant questions. And I'm like, if you guys, is actually three guys and a girl, if you would like to learn more, I went and created the 20 Books to 50K Facebook group. I said, let's move our conversations out of my author, you know, reader scenario, and let's move it over to this place and I'll help you. So I did. And the four of them did books and we released them, and all four of them got into the top 10,000, first book out. And I thought that was pretty cool, you know, because, you know, my background does come from a religious background, and the whole thing of you can give a person a fish, but if you teach them how to fish, you know, they'll eat forever. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I can teach them what I know. And so I did. And they were able to move forward with it. Now, if they choose to go a different path, that's not on me. But they were successful and they were taught. And so at that time, I was also on K-Boards. Now, K-Boards is a little different today. At that particular moment in time, there were some challenges with people such as, say, myself coming out and going, hey, I have this success. And then you have some people asking about it and other people that basically wanted to tear you apart. And I'm like, you know what? I don't need this. I'm trying to help people. There's no value for me to sit here and have arguments with people. I've got the next book to write. So I'm going to go over to this little group that I created called 20 Books. And if any of you want to know more, come check it out. We have very simple rules, just two of them, which I'll give the politically correct versions are don't be a jerk and don't try to market your books. My biggest concern for marketing the books was you have, and I had this picture of an indie author, no books to speak of. It's a woman who has a baby with Enfamil, which is expensive. And someone says, can you buy my 99-cent book? And she's taking milk money to go help some other author because that's how authors can be. Mm. And I'm like, I don't want that in my group. You know, authors aren't a great place to market to anyway because they're not supposed to be, unless, of course, you sell author books.
Yeah, they're not your direct readership.
Yes, exactly.
I mean, so maybe they are, but they're not the readers that you're looking
for. Yeah, and you don't want authors to be, anyway, there's a whole lot of reasons it's not a good choice. For me, however, it was just, I didn't want that one author who shouldn't be buying 99 cents even have to stress out about it. So that's why the second rule is there. So that was the beginning of it. And once it went up on K-Boards, we went from 4 people. I thought I'd have 8. We went to 80.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, what's it at now?
34,000.
Oh my God.
Wow.
So it and that is from a lot of people. If anyone knows the Linux story, Linus Torvald story, it's very similar to that situation where one person started it and then I had to grab some friends and family, not family, but friends to help me run the first few hundred and then more people and more people. And then, you know, there's been a lot of people who have helped support the growth of 20 Books to 50K.
That's awesome. And what led to the creation of the conference, I guess, was just that having a place for this to...
The 3,500 people?
Well,
yeah, do you get everyone? That would be like an awfully large conference.
Yeah, no, it's not everyone. And so like any new exciting, I mean, indie publishing now has been around a decade, but every year when you get into it, it's exciting. It's something new. Especially if you have a few people start reading your book and you realize if I just write, they will come. You know, the first time that I figured out that if I wrote a short story, I could go write something that then I could go buy myself $1,000 item because I sat down and wrote hard for 2 days. You know, that was very liberating to go. It's not on somebody else's approval if I make more money. It's on whether or not I'm willing to put the time in. And so with 20 Books, I was talking with Craig Martell, and Craig had had a less than a stellar experience at a conference, and he felt that we could do better for less money because 20 Books is nonprofit. We don't have a legitimate like nonprofit organization. We just don't take profit. And so he and I talked about it, and I'm like, yes, we can do this. And we agreed that Las Vegas, at the time, I had a condo, but we didn't live here. And so we're like, okay, let's do Vegas because a couple of things. Once again, cheap. We're constantly worried about what's the price this is going to be because if we want to help the most amount of people, we have to be the most available to people. And so Vegas, what seemed to be the most logical place that we could get easy flights into for the most of the world, right? Because it's subsidized. And the best facilities for the least expensive price that we felt we could get. So that became Vegas. Once the hotel and everything was found, then that was 2017 was the first one. We got 400, which was quite nice. I mean, it was like, wow, 400. At that time, I think we had 20,000 maybe in the group, 18, somewhere in there. And we cut our teeth. We, meaning Craig mainly, cut his teeth on building that one. The rule or the agreement Craig and I have is very one-sided toward me.
Craig, raw deal.
He did get the raw deal in the first 2 years. I will say it, and I told him when he was here a couple of weeks ago, he was here setting up the final things for this year's conference. He's like, I need it in person. So I went with him, and after coming out of that multi-hour meeting, I said, you know, I got to say thank you because I would not be experiencing the opportunities of meeting these people without him. So we have a partnership. We collaborate on doing this, but he makes it happen. And the rules are simple. I don't have to get involved in the day-to-day nitty-gritty stuff of doing this conference. And in exchange, I won't tell him who to put on stage. So even to this day, if I want somebody to be there, I take off my hat and I call him up. I go, hat in hand, hey, Craig, what do you think about this? So I honor that pledge with him. And in exchange, I've not had to do any major lifting whatsoever with the conferences, whether they're here, Edinburgh, Adelaide, London, you know, wherever they're at.
Although I do think it was your idea for the push-up contest.
That part is a little bit, that is a unique story in the 20 book history. Let's talk about that. So we have Chrissy, right?
Yep.
And we have Mark. So Kobo luminaries. Let's talk about this. We're talking Kobo luminaries.
Oh, yeah. And icons.
icons of Kobo.
Yes.
If I understand the story correctly, Mark hired Chrissy.
Oh, yeah.
So now we have a little bit slightly different situation. So now Mark, which if anyone has seen Mark, Mark is Sasquatch. Very tall man. Very built man. So he has done multiple running and exercises. And then you have Chrissy, which is not Mark. But she has the attitude of a Mark plus, right? So last year at NINC, which is held in Florida, and I understand you ladies just probably got back from there?
Yeah.
Is that right?
You did, yep.
You did. And a lot of fun, right?
Oh, it was
great.
Well,
Kobo, did you put on an event this year at NINC?
We did, yep.
Okay. So last year's event, Kobo also put one on. And it was kind of like a wine open bar. For me, it was open Coke, the drink, not the white substance. So I'm there. Now, I'm fully within my cognitive ability. Perhaps Chrissy wasn't. You know, she is the person that having to talk to everyone. So she has to have a drink that she's walking around. And I didn't get there right when it opened. So I set this up for that reason. Now, I see Mark. He's over with a group of people. They're talking. And Chrissy's walking around because she's the one who has to actually work the event. And she comes by and we talk for a little while. She mentioned something about being really competitive and a few other things. And I'm like, so I pitched her the idea. I'm like, so you're saying that you could beat Mark? Oh, yes, I'm competitive. So you could do more push-ups than Mark. Oh, I could beat him hands down. It wouldn't even be a problem. I'm like, so if we did a competition and we gave the money to charity, you'd be okay with this. Oh, you know, not a problem.
See, what didn't you didn't she... know is that we all, like, secretly coveted Chrissy's arms here at Kobo.
Oh,
because
yeah.
She's so, like...
She's like a runner.
A strong lady. Yeah.
Yes. I intend to run to the nearest restaurant. That's my intention of running. So I go over. I remember being really excited for no particularly good reason. So I go over there. Mark is talking to, I want to say, like, Damon Courtney. And I can't think of like two or three others. I think one might have been Kevin Tomlinson. And I'm like, hey, what do you think about a push-up contest? You versus Chrissy. We're going to give the money to charity. Are you in? And Mark was like, you know, he's kind of, yeah, okay, that sounds good. And I go, great. So we have money from you. And at that point, his eyes might have gotten a little wider. And then we go, well, it would have been his charity. And Kevin, you know, is drafted digital in. And Kevin's like, sure. So I get to it because LMBPN, I'm like, I'm in. Mm-hmm. So I get like a handful of people. And they're all saying, yes, they'll do it. So I go back to Chrissy. I'm like, great, it's on. And she's like, what's on? At 20 books this year, we're going to have a push-up contest between you and Mark on stage for charity. We're going to do this. And that's how it started. And of course, we're sitting here in October right now. So you're only talking about a month, month and a half between NINC and 20 books. And then Chrissy starts, I'm like, I talk to her occasionally and she's like, yeah, right down there next. And ladies, you probably tell the story better. By her desk, she dun 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 dun.
Oh, yeah. She was full of Rocky mode. She was training.
Yeah, we had push-up con.
There's a push-up club here at Kobo. So everyone does push-ups at like 3 p.m.
And then she was there every day.
Yeah.
Getting her push-ups in.
Yeah. It was quite a thing.
And I find out from Mark that Mark is not exactly the same until his significant other got involved. You are not going to be a disgrace. And so sure enough, I think it might have been day two or something. You know, in the middle of the afternoon, we have everybody in the main auditorium, which is a stage. Rock stars. There have been concerts there. And those two on stage. And then Mark comes up, pulls off his jacket, and honest to God, Spider-Man shirt on. I'm like, really? And then Chrissy comes up and she's got sweatband stuff. I mean, she's decked out as well. I'm like, this is the best $400 I've ever spent.
I think that's the best thing that they both had charities for children's literacy. So either way, who won or lost, it was great that they both got to provide money for charities.
We'll just say Chrissy did win.
I was trying to be so diplomatic, Steph.
No, I'm just going to... They can watch the video somewhere.
I'm sure the video is still on the 20 Books group.
Yes, yes. It was really a lot of fun. We did videotape it. We put it out there, and Kobo was amazing to be a part of that. I heard later, or even might have been that event, that everyone at the Kobo offices were watching it being live streamed.
Yeah.
And that kind of touched my heart.
We might have disrupted some people working.
But I think we we made sure it wasn't during a meeting so we could watch it.
Yeah. I think we might have moved some things around. But
oh, that is awesome. Yeah. That is really neat.
And I don't, like, that was, you know, one of our highlights from 20 Books last year. What was something else that happened that came out of the conference? Is there stuff that you can tell us that you learn from putting on these conferences, or just being involved in 20 Books in general?
Well, there's a few things. 20 Books, depending on where you are in your publishing journey, right? Because there are things that you need to know if you've never pushed the button, as I like to say, or if you have pushed the button and hit publish, or if you're finding it challenging no matter which direction you choose in the strategy for your company. And then you have the next step up, which is relationships. I do think you kind of need to understand a little bit of what you're doing before you can understand how a relationship would matter to you. For example, if I ask you, where are you on a publisher-writer scale? A writer at a 1, the scale of 1 to 10, if you're a 1, you're the writer who sits in front of, it might be a typewriter, doesn't matter. They push a pizza and my favorite Coke drink, Coca-Cola, underneath the door, and that's all you do. You write, you push a manuscript back out the door, right? That's what you love to do. Or you have someone who's a 10, which is a publisher. They don't write any books. They love the data. They love, you know, making sure that they've done the deals. And that's really a true publisher, a quote unquote true publisher. And then you get those that are effective publishers, which are more of a 7, which is they love the stories. They get involved. They understand that, but they really like the business side of it more, right? And then you have the number 3 writer. They love the writing, but they like to kind of be involved in the business as well. And then you have those that are 5s. They're equal parts both. And they love it the most. And you'll hear them say it like, I love to be the ability to make all the decisions. I love no one to be able to tell me what I need to do on my cover. I love no one to be able to tell me this. That kind of starts to, like, I'll listen to that. And the first thing I think is maybe they lean publisher. And then they'll like say, but oh, my stories, like it's so, I'm like, oh, okay, now we're back to 5s. I'm a 7. I love to get involved in stories, but I don't want to write all the time. That is not me. I love having conversations like this. I love talking the business. I love talking like, have you seen the new genre change that's going on? These things, like, you know, my brain starts snapping when that stuff goes on. And so I think that there was a question we talked about a little bit earlier, I think before we started, which is, where's the industry going? And to answer that question, you have to realize, one, we've been here once before in the industry, right? Before TradPub became a thing. And then really every time that there's been an upset in the distribution mechanism, it has changed. And it's usually led, there's a Mike Shatskin book that talks about this, but it's usually romance, mystery, thriller, right? Science fiction or urban fantasy, science fiction, as they put it together. It used to be Westerns, right? Westerns in those 4 core genres would come through. And that's how, when you did things like book clubs, that was a new distribution paradigm. And those genres changed first before the rest of them eventually started moving through. And I think we're probably in our 3rd iteration of distribution and how it's changed with ebooks. And ebooks now, because of the publishing, have been around the world. It's not in all the other countries. It's in some countries, they're antagonistic to ebooks. And they're having to change laws in the country, or at least adjust the laws to allow ebooks a chance to survive. And so we see that near. I don't know what it's like in Canada. Are y'all is pretty much just as open here as the States?
Yeah,
I would say.
So we have that situation. And I see that the maturation of this cycle of where we're at in the publishing arena with indie publishers. Trad had a certain style and a certain way of doing contracts. And that has led to thousands of authors not going that direction who know about it. There are 1,000 others who have no clue about indie, even though we would think, how could you not? They don't know. And so for those that understand the indie opportunity and are willing to do the business side, because writing a book and sticking on a distributor, chances are highly unlikely, not impossible, but highly unlikely, you're going to get your book sold. You have to do the business side. You have to get involved with, once again, the ad capabilities of Kobo, for example. And the status is that you have a bunch of indie individuals. Now then you start to become either indie collaborative, indie collective, indie publishers where some of them are coming as a part of. We get to a certain point where money seeks money opportunities, and that's an indie industry. And what I mean by that is eventually someone's going to say, there are enough small companies in this indie publishing that are doing the job and making money. I can believe if I invest in them or buy them, it will become a profit center for me. And that will occur. I was part of the 1999-2001 change to people buying a bunch of IT companies and rolling them up. And their goal, of course, is they go buy six or seven smaller ones, roll it up into one company, give it a good set of books, and sell that. And that's how they get out of it. And then that, of course, and so on. The challenge in our industry that's different. If I want to run cable, that's pretty much the same running cable, no matter if you're on the East Coast or the West Coast. If you need cable run, it's the same. I think about the readership of any books as if you took a rock and you slammed it into the car windshield. You know how it'll stay together, but then you're going to see nothing but small little cracks, you know, small little pieces. Now take a black marker and start drawing around three or four of them. That's a very small genre. Mm-hmm. And you can draw bigger ones. Nobody can own it all. Nobody can, because there's too much bifurcation in what's going on. Yeah. So we're always going to have that opportunity to create the small guy again. I don't think we're going to lose the opportunity. Some of what we do now with LMBPN, I've seen the history. It's been done multiple times in different distribution mechanisms. I'm not creating anything new. I'm just taking advantage of the new distribution mechanism.
Yeah. Well, what's the genre that you're focusing on now? Because you have this new series coming out, Opus X. I don't know if the two are related or if I'm giving away some of your secrets now. But.
No. No. I've helped a lot of people, and I've helped certainly dozens personally where I've interacted. And one of the things I found out was that people had what's called a passion project, and it's that story that they have to tell. Unfortunately, that story oftentimes is not sellable. You know, what fascinates them is so unique, it doesn't necessarily fascinate enough people to do something with. When I encounter someone, I learned relatively early, don't try to get them not to do the passion project if you don't think it's going to be viable. One, I could be wrong. That would suck. Two, they need to learn it for themselves. My first series, Carthirian Gambit, I was successful on. Great. Then I went and did some other things and I found out success. So then one itch that I had was my belief that an amazing set of graphics, if you could write into the, it would be a, not only, obviously, if you know how to write, good set of stories, but my passion project. I wanted something to be able to say that is just amazing visual. And so we've spent about a year and a half from when we met Gene Malika at Gene Malika Studios, hiring models, getting 3D cars built by professionals, getting a 3D gun model built, getting seven or eight boxes of Hollywood props sent to New York to do a photo shoot. And the goal behind this is we don't have enough, we LMBPN and myself, Michael Anderle, do not have enough experience how to go after the world. And that's one of the next steps for us indie publishers, publishing company, hybrid models. We need more experience in that. And the guys and girls who know how to do it, they're not sharing. Imagine that. We here in the indie are used to everybody telling us how to do stuff. Well, they don't unnecessarily tell you how to do anything. And some of the ways that they know how to do it, I don't agree with. We could wax philosophical about how bookstores operate right now. And I'll tell you, that, well, the way the bookstores operate go back to like World War I, World War II, and the Great Depression. I'm like, that's not a way to run companies anymore, and I refuse to get involved in that. So I'll either not get involved, an option, or I'll figure out how to go past it, which is the one that I'm working on. But worldwide, specifically, it takes a new set of marketing skills, marketing understanding, capabilities, assessments, relationships, knowledge that I didn't have. And there is one thing that's said, this is in trad specifically, if you know the size of the advance the author received, you'll know how much marketing money they're going to put behind it, right? If the person got six figures, good chance they're going to market that book. If the person got $3,000, not a high chance they're going to market that book. And I'm like, you know what? I need to put it as my name, right? It's my book, because if I fail, I'm going to fail really expensively. It needs to be something that I'm all in on. So that's not a one book and done. I know series. I want this. So my tentpole project became, I'm going to learn how to do wide, how to engage with Kobo, how to go everywhere you guys go for 18 plus months, guaranteed, because that's what we're doing. And so Opus X behind me, you know, when you look at that, I still get chills. So for anyone who's just listening,
yeah,
I'm turning around in my office chair and I'm looking at the sign and it's like 3 feet wide and 6 feet tall or 7 feet tall, 7'6". And it reminds you a little bit of what movies would you say? Can you all see it well enough?
It's sort of like Blade Runner,
yeah,
kind of
Matrix-y.
Yeah,
Blade Runner, Matrix, Ghost in the Shell, or however that is. Ghost in the Shell, or yeah, Shell.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's very much the future that I was looking for. You know, anyway, I could sit there and just stare at it longingly. And I'm excited to get it out. There's videos. I don't know if y'all have seen the 3D video.
I have. That's why I wanted to mention that, like, you've got such fresh marketing ideas for this series. We're going to be sharing some when this podcast goes on YouTube.
I'll throw some in. Yeah, do it.
But yeah, it's been really exciting to see the different videos. And it's just such, like I said, a fresh perspective to an indie book campaign that I haven't seen before.
And part of that is due to Kobo, right? Every 3 weeks, y'all are pleasant enough and take up your time to jump on a call to help school us. You know, come on, LMBPN, you can do this. And, you know, we appreciate that. We say it internally. We appreciate our partners so much for helping us understand what in the world we're going to do. And I know we're going to make mistakes. But unlike others, perhaps, we're going to share what those are. You know, we are going to talk about it this year at 20 Books. We're going to talk about it next year at 20 Books. What's going on? Maybe we're successful. Maybe we fail. I don't know. I'm not overly worried. I mean, it's a lot of money.
I was going to say.
But every time that you're the first through it, you're going to pay a premium. You're going to pay a high premium. And I know that there are many, many, many successful authors who are on Kobo, who are on the other platforms, and they have built a following. Everything that I've watched, read in 20 Books says, expect 6 to 9 months. Mm-hmm. Expect it. And I'm like, you know what? I'm all in for 18 months plus. So if I'm going to take over the world, so to speak, and crack the full market, we've got to be able to invest in this. So we're in it for $250,000+ of effort.
I think that's a great kind of point with going wide that some people kind of can be a little bit frightened about, that it does take time. And like, I think that the fact that you're willing to kind of give this a certain timeline is, it's kind of beneficial for other authors to kind of realize as well when they're trying to crack that wide market.
Well, one thing that I hear this, and you probably do as well, authors who are successful wide said, I tried Amazon. It didn't work. And instead of beating their head against the wall over and over and over again, they went and tried wide and all of a sudden they have success. I don't know anyone who can say, I can make you successful wide or I can make you successful on Amazon. There's a lot that can do well, but the massive success, I don't know that without spending a lot of money that they can do that. And I don't know. We're going to spend a lot of money. We're going to have the highest quality stuff that we can. We're going to put ourselves on a good foot. We're going to connect with the partners who have interest because, I mean, if you take it down to brass tacks, if I'm making money on Kobo, Kobo's making money on Kobo. You know, so there's a great interest in from that perspective, but that's true for everybody that you do, right? Kobo really takes care of their indie authors, and that is evident.
Yeah, we always say to just for authors to reach out to us, and we're always game to experiment with different promotions. And every retailer has different opportunities. So part of the challenge of going wide is kind of learning each retailer's tricks, so to speak.
Like talking to them about stuff.
Yeah, just reaching out. Yeah, you think you're bothering us, but you're not.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting. People have asked me, why do I take LMBP into the four majors? Meaning Frankfurt, London, New York, and Beijing book fairs each year. And I said, because there's not much limitation to anyone becoming an indie publisher. Write a book, get a cover, get editing. The education is out there. The book covers can be done relatively inexpensively. The editing is there. You can be in business. Now you take it to the next level. Now, if somebody wants to take and compete with LMBPN, you need to go to the four majors. Oh, by the way, we've done that now 3 years. So, you know, we're going into our third year with Frankfurt. We're going, and it takes each time to accomplish it. And so I want that barrier to entry. When we go for wide, guess what? It's a barrier to entry. Exactly what you just said. We need to create the relationships with Kobo. We have to create the relationships with everybody else, understand your systems and what it does. And when that happens and we're successful, I liken it to be, would you rather be a small frog in a big pond or a big frog in a smaller pond? I want to be that big frog. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to be able to tell other authors who are signing with LMBPN, because we've become more of a hybrid publisher, do you want wide? And I've had the discussion now with a new person who can only put out a book maybe once every 6 months, which for a lot of indies is slow. For a lot of trad people are like, man, that's fast. And so what I told her was, she has book one done. She's finishing book two, and then it's going to take her 6 to 9 months for three. I'm like, all right, I'll tell you what. What we can do is we can put one and two, and just to get some people happy, we could go, because it's quick, into KU. But then we can yank it out, because long term, you're a wide author. You know, if you're going to be spending 6 to 9 months minimum, because for whatever quality reason, that's what you're going to release as, then probably wide is something you might want to consider, because you'll be a flash in the pan on KU. You know, unless you want to do a 300,000 word book, in which case, explain 6 to 9 months. But there's so many opportunities for us right now. Mm-hmm. Be that bigger person. It will be pretty amazing when I get to see Opus X on Kobo.
Yeah, I'm excited. I think our pre-orders are already up, right? I
believe yes. So.
Mm-hmm. Just for anyone who's curious, can you just give us like a quick plot synopsis and like how many titles are in the series?
There will be 12 titles. There are 6 up for pre-order right now because of telling us to go a year at a time, not what we knew. So we changed that. It is, the synopsis is, there's rot in the Federation. If you look at Asimov's situation where, you know, the frontier is out there somewhere, right? So one of our people, something disastrous happens to his military group. He's coming back to the center of civilization Earth to find out where is that rot. Likewise, we have the female who's a part of this and doesn't understand the rot that's underneath her feet. So it's two rebels whose worlds collide, and they will then travel getting to know each other and solving this problem over the 12 books, which will take them throughout the known human universe.
Wow. Nice. Sounds interesting. And have you written them all?
No, I'm working on the editing of book 3.
Okay.
And book 1 releases November 1st, 6 weeks for every release. Dreamscape has already procured the rights for all 12. So we have a partner who is just as fast as we're publishing, they are publishing. So, you know, we are, what is that, the 15th, around January 28th or 4th or something, the third book comes out. I'll have the edits done in the next 30 days, tops. One thing different about LMBPN, we can do up to 2 million editing words a month in our company. Oh, wow. So when I'm done, and I do get a little bit of premier service being the guy that owns the company, you know, the team at the editing group will get on it, and, you know, we'll have it in time. That gets to Dreamscape early because they have a person that's running it. And I'm really happy with what I've heard from them.
Great. Awesome. Yeah, we're excited to see these books when they release.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I guess my final question, you may have already answered this, but like, what do you think is the best thing you've done for your business?
Help other people, because a lot of my decisions have been altruistic in nature, and I've been shocked at how many times that I found the business reason that it was a good idea. I'll give a small example. When you see collaborative books, right? Then you know, if you have somebody, and I'm not picking on James Patterson because I think he's a phenomenal businessman and author and everything else, but you will see that the name is really huge. And then you have the collaborator who spent writing most of these particular type of books, right, underneath it in a smaller font. I didn't understand that. I used to rail against it, that whole justice thing. That's not right. We know that Bob Smith or Tanya Smith really wrote most of this book, right? And I'm sure, because I've had the experience, James might have been majorly a part of writing the beats. Could be. So I decided I'm going to have Tanya Smith in this example as the name above mine. I put my name underneath, and the rule is/was names are the same size, right? That was great because, one, it did accomplish them credit, which is what I wanted to do. I didn't realize, actually, that they would also get the blame if it was a horrible book, you know, or the fans just didn't like it. They didn't blame me necessarily, but that wasn't my intent in doing it. And so it allowed different things on the distributors. Guess which name comes up first? Well, their name. In this example, Tanya Smith. So if I had a book high in the rank and two of my collaborators have high books in the rank, it doesn't look like Michael Anderle, Michael Anderle, Michael Anderle. It looks like three different authors are putting these books out. And all of a sudden now we have a situation where a person might say, I don't like that Michael Anderle for whatever reason. And I have had them say that. But they'll still give the other two authors an even chance, which is fantastic. And so it ended up being a benefit to me that I didn't ever expect because I didn't know that it would be there. So in doing it, I started early in my career, book 8, I think, I put in a bunch of hello type of blurbs from other authors to help push them. I wasn't writing fast enough for whale readers. They need a book every day, every 3 days. And so I release a book and 24 hours later, great, when's the next one? Not now, but let me talk to you about so-and-so's book. So I started doing that as well. Well, what happened is the readers, so that's altruistic, go read them. A little bit opportunistic, please stop bugging me because you're stressing me out. And then what happened is the fans are like, I really appreciate what you do for these other authors. They didn't leave me because they went on, well, some might have. But in general, they actually tied them more emotionally to me for giving these other authors a chance and giving the reader someone else to read. And I became someone that they trusted in that way. So altruism became a business opportunity.
Nice. That's a nice little note to end this on, I think.
Yeah. Did we cover everything? Do you have anything else? Any final points?
Learn the basics. Learn which way that's going to work for you, that you're going to be happy. This can take, yes, I'm a poster boy for having success fast. I'm rare. So plan on it being something that you're going to do for a while, which means that some of your decisions will be affected that way. You know, an example of this might be, don't get into a series that you're not going to want to write in 3 or 4 books, because that's when you're going to start getting the success. Too many of the people I see, they put out book 2, book 3, a lot of success. They get bored. They write the next bright, shiny, and everything flops. Because they're like, the people were like, where's 5? You're losing me here on this contract between you write, I read. So that would be a thought. Not as much fun as the altruistic comment.
No, let's get that.
Yeah, no, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure.
Who are you? Gia demanded. You're not with my enforcement zone. I don't recognize you.
That's because I just started working tonight. Detective Eric Blackwell, Enforcement Zone 122. The gray-haired cop strolled over to the flitter. He opened the door and John fell out with a groan. The cop knelt and pulled out a bright white strip from a pocket, a binding tie. He set his rifle down and shoved John's wrists together before slapping the tie down. It grew in an instant and wrapped around the drunk's wrists. Gia let out a strangled laugh.
You're in my enforcement zone?
Yes. Like I said, I just started. Eric tapped his PNIU. This is Detective Eric Blackwell requesting an ambulance for... He glanced at the downed Cyrus. 2 suspects with minor injuries, send along a patrol car too. The primary situation's been handled, but there's some cleanup for them to do. He looked back at her with a slight grin. You're lucky I showed up when I did.
Listen, Detective Blackwell, Gia began. I don't know what or where you transferred from, but what you did was totally unacceptable.
Eric shook his head. Local department regulations clearly state that all officers are allowed to discharge weapons up to and including lethal discharge in defense of any imminent threats to the lives of themselves, other officers, or citizens. I'd say getting plowed into by a drunk definitely counts as an imminent threat. He grabbed his rifle and stared down at the unconscious John before moving over to Cyrus and slapping on a binding tie on the downed man. She pointed around them.
You could have killed someone, Gia suggested.
Could have? Sure. But I didn't, now did I? Eric walked back toward her. Trust me, I wasn't using armor-piercing bullets. I knew if I hit the emitters or the main vehicle body, the bullets wouldn't go anywhere else. I've taken down a vehicle or 50 in my time. Gia scoffed.
You hit those things because you got lucky.
Lucky? Eric shook his head and patted his gun. You know what this is? Gia shrugged.
Overkill? A symbol of your enormous ego? A desire to produce something you believe flatters you?
Her eyes glanced down
an unflattering smile on her face as she eyed him back. Should I go on? Eric snickered. I like that, but no. It's a TR-7 quad. 4 selectable barrels. He stroked the weapon like a pet. If I wanted to kill someone, I would flip this to 4-barrel mode and open up, draining the mags in seconds. The bullets would have shredded that car like it was a leaf in a tornado. He nodded at the vehicle. Or I could have just fired several times into the driver. Instead, I took out the emitters and engine to ground the vehicle. He grunted. Not even the fool who was trying to kill you will die. No, trust me. I'm a big believer in luck, but this time Lady Luck was nowhere around. He patted his chest. This was all me. Gia tucked her stun pistol back into her purse. I pity your new partner.
Thank you for listening to the Kobo Writing Life podcast. If you're looking for Michael's series Opus X, you can find it on Kobo's store. Or extra tips on how to grow your sales, visit kobowritinglife.com.
This episode was produced by Stephanie McGrath and Tara Kremen. Music was provided by Tearjerker. This episode was edited by Kelly Robotham. And special thanks to Michael for being a guest on our episode. If you're ready to start your self-publishing journey today, sign up for free at kobo.com/writinglife. Until next time, happy writing.